So, ladies and gentlemen, I thought that before I talked about Bega Cheese specifically, I should perhaps give some context to the way we think about our business in terms of food and our position both in the Australian market and the international market. I think that, you know, sometimes you do need to step back and have a look at what's actually going on in the world of food, because there's a lot of media and there's a lot of press about population growth and the challenges that the globe may have in feeding itself, and indeed what the position might be of various companies in that supply chain. So it is interesting to look over history. So this has been this is work that's been done by System IQ or Systemic. And I think it's interesting to go back to even the early 80s. We've actually been quite successful in feeding a growing population. In fact, we've been phenomenally successful. Food is actually relatively cheap in historic terms. And indeed, a lot of food waste comes out of the fact that food is, it could be argued, too cheap. We've actually succeeded in growing yields on almost every form of food product that we produce, and we've actually seen food prices in real terms continue to decrease, as has global undernourishment. So you would say, you know, compared to, say, when we had a population of 2.5 billion at the end of World War II, we talk about a population of 7.5 or 8 billion today, we've been terribly successful in feeding them. We've done an outstanding job in agriculture and food supply chains to deliver food to most consumers in most parts of the world. But of course, that has come at a cost. And as we look forward and think about where we position our business, we have to think about the disruptors that will be part of the food industry into the future. Whether that's climate change, environmental degradation, the way a modern day consumer behaves, or indeed the impact of tech on farm. So again, if we look forward, and I know the market is impatient and doesn't necessarily always want to take a long view, but if we look forward, we can see that climate change is going to affect the relative production capacity of various parts of the globe in a frightening way. Now, you would say, when you see that picture, that places like Australia could indeed see advantage in terms of its ability to produce food. But when we think about the disruption created by climate change, it will be enormous. And in terms of how that environmental degradation will drive food insecurity in a growing population is something that we have to think about. And it's indeed also something that we need to think about around how it will affect the reaction of our consumers into the future. So what do I spend a lot of time thinking about today? I think a lot about the fact that we now have very much what could be described as conscious consumption. Consumers are increasingly health conscious, and they're increasingly interested in their impact on the global food supply chain. Obviously, things like food safety are extraordinarily important and explains to a large extent that extraordinary demand for infant formula into China, for example. Health and well-being is very much part of the way every young and indeed every aging consumer tends to think about food as medicine, in other words. It is a huge growing trend that will only get larger as that demographic change around individualization continues to occur. And of course, organic and local. So people are very interested. And the organic and local does fit in with the food safety and the health and well-being part, but it also fits into issues of climate change. It also fits into issues like food miles. And of course, we're very aware, and we saw it last week, the growing demand for plant-based foods rather than animal-based foods. And they're all things that we think about as a dairy company. Interestingly, technology is going to play a larger and larger part in agriculture. It hasn't done so in the past, or I would argue that ag and ag tech is a long way behind every other sector in terms of its adoption of technology and the disruption and the difference it can make. So we think deeply about that. I'm not going to go into those various areas there, except to perhaps point to the last one on the screen there, which is interestingly, even for me as somebody that's been around the dairy industry for decades, we always talk about the fact that we can now track an animal and they'll have a tag in their ear that will tell you what's going on with them every day, and their supply is measured, and to a certain extent some of their consumption is measured. Of course, most of my younger generation colleagues think that that is old tech. And of course, we use facial recognition now. And I keep going, but they all look the same. And they go, no, they don't. No, they don't. They don't all look the same. And they do indeed. And therefore, the level at which these animals are monitored and their outputs, and indeed, their methane output will be increasingly measured into the future to make sure that they have a role in a future food supply chain. I'm not going to dwell on this too much, except to say that when we think about our business, we think about the entire supply chain. At the centre is the customer and the future customer. Now, interestingly, you might think that middle image is about that young girl in the future someday becoming a Bega cheese customer of some sort. The truth is we shouldn't underestimate her pester power capability even today. If you think about what that young girl is thinking about, she's thinking about plastics in the ocean. She's thinking about climate change. She's thinking about health. And when we think about the other end of that customer profile, we're thinking about an ageing population that are worried about health and well-being and nutrition into the future. Food service is an enormous part of the way we develop our international business. And of course, that will be out-of-home eating we see as very much a big part of the future consumer. I'm not going to dwell because I'm going to run out of time, but this is something that I just mentioned earlier. The amount of tech that will go onto farm will change the way farming practices are carried out, and indeed, the way in which farms are invested in. You will see large expenditure, capital will replace labour, and you'll see large amounts of automation starting to come into farm, which will lead to greater levels of efficiency and more discerning resource use. So what does all that mean to Bega Cheese? It means we have to continue to transform. It means that we have to be an ever-changing business to meet the ever-changing demands of our customers, wherever they might be in the world, but also what's happening in the supply chain. I have been with this business a long time. And indeed, it was a very small business in 2001, producing just a few thousand tonnes of cheese from one singular site. We recognised that we didn't want to be a single product business. We recognised that we wanted to continue to go forward and access global markets. So in 2007, we bought Datura Milk Industries, which was a very strong export business selling to Japan, but importantly, with very strong infant formula capacities and nutritional capacities. We continued to grow our core business in 2008-09 by becoming the largest cheese cut and processing company in Australia, or indeed probably in the Southern Hemisphere. We listed on the market in 2011. And in 2017, we further transformed by adding a significant sales and marketing capacity to the business and indeed the iconic Vegemite brand to our portfolio of products, moving from just a pure dairy business to a genuine food business, which includes products like peanut butter, which sits very strongly in that health and wellness category. We're all about natural foods, where we can point to provenance and point to a controlled supply chain right the way through. Indeed, our customer can meet our farmer. And we see that as, interestingly, a very traditional model of how food was delivered, but the model of the future. And I guess what we would argue is that that has been extraordinarily successful for us. So unless you don't read any newspapers, you would know the dairy industry has been through enormous turmoil in the last 5 to 10 years. And during that period of time, Bega has consistently navigated its way through that turmoil. We were probably back in 2000, we might have been in the top 25 or 30 dairy companies in Australia. We are now, without doubt, the largest Australian-owned dairy company, and we take in excess of 1 billion litres of milk across and transform that across a range of products from high-end micronutrients right through to, of course, the famous Bega cheese and infant nutritionals. And, of course, we now have sites across the east coast of Australia. So our value proposition is fundamentally one of a high quality infrastructure with an iconic brand portfolio, a really well-established operating model, and because what you quite often see in times of turmoil in industries is that there's this constant change of executive at the top end while they're searching for solution. Bega's probably got the record for having the most stable transitions possible in terms of how we have changed leadership over the period of time that I've led the business. And that does lead to a very stable and calm operating model in difficult circumstances. We've got a diversified and balanced portfolio. Our ambition is to have 50% of our business in Australia and 50% of our business internationally. Of course, that can change from time to time as we make acquisition. And of course, we went more strongly into Australia when we purchased Vegemite, because you might have noticed that not many people actually overseas like Vegemite, but in Australia it's a very strong product and we love owning it. But of course, in other areas, particularly dairy, we're growing strongly overseas, and our most recent acquisition last August of Koroit, dairy manufacturing site in Western Victoria, has allowed that growth internationally, and will continue with that goal of 50% of our business in Australia and 50% internationally. It's important to have strong relationships with your suppliers, which we do, and of course, as that previous graph outlined, we've just been able to continue to grow our business strongly. And it is an integrated business. I've touched on a few of the numbers, a few of the areas earlier, but fundamentally, this table shows it well. A business that starts with a raw material from a farmer. In our case these days, it's either milk or indeed it's peanuts. I might say, for those who don't know, peanuts are one of the cheapest proteins available anywhere in the world. Now, we can do very simple things with them and sell them as commodities on the international markets when that is the sensible thing to do. But the ambition in life is to, of course, add value to those raw materials. We look to do that through the creation of high-end nutritionals, as I mentioned earlier, infant formula, lactoferrin, products like that. We, of course, make cheese, and we look to either supply that into our brand or other people's brands, both here and overseas. And indeed, we value add other people's cheese products into retail ready packs. And of course, we now have a marketing and retail and sales arm that is second to none, which was what the business really lacked until we purchased that Bega Foods business a couple of years ago. And that allows us to enter the retail markets in Australia very strongly, the food service markets in Australia and around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, I am going to run out of time, but we have also, and we don't talk too much about this, but seeing it was in our half-yearly reports, I'll mention it here. We've opened a little new ventures platform, which is very much, I guess, a trend for large business, where we recognise that the entrepreneurial skill and the presence of online businesses these days mean that sometimes an organisation like us will not access all opportunities. We will recognise we've got great capability in R&D, we've got great capability in delivering high-value products, but there are niches in the market that we may miss. And I think in the past, we always looked at new businesses and acquisitions that we had to own 100%. We now sit there and say there is a space for entrepreneurs within our business. They need to be left alone to do do what entrepreneurs do, but we can put an engine behind them to grow their business and get a benefit by both being a supplier, a source of R&D, but also an equity holder. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm always proud to show our sites and how we've grown, but given time, I will go past it. I guess what I've done with this presentation, which I assume will be made available, is include the half-yearly result. But the half-yearly result had some key messages in it that I'd like to leave you with today. Bega Cheese is now one of the largest milk handlers in Australia following its acquisition of Koroit in Western Victoria. Everybody would know that the drought has impacted dairy supply across the country, but it's particularly impacted in Northern Victoria. The water policy in Northern Victoria and the issues around the Murray-Darling are well documented. It means that one of our key facilities in Northern Victoria, being Tatura Milk Industries, needs to be integrated with a future view that we won't see much milk growth in Northern Victoria. Western Victoria is now Australia's largest milk production region. It was the right area for us to make a new acquisition where indeed milk supply will continue to grow, where the circumstances for milk supply to grow is strong. That being integrated with our high quality nutritional infrastructure at Tatura means that we've de-risked that part of our business and some of the climatic impacts of what's going on in Northern Victoria. I mentioned earlier that we've had a very successful milk acquisition program. We've actually grown our milk supply by 55% in a period where milk supply in the country has been decreasing. We continue to invest in high-end nutrients. We did actually make a decision to close one of our plants given the milk supply in Australia and replace what was an old and somewhat inefficient mozzarella capacity with a third-party contract manufacturer opportunity that sees us able to grow that business but avoid capital. We've been delighted to see Bega Foods business stabilising. We mentioned at the half year we had a challenging first half and gave guidance on where we thought the full year would look. That was largely impacted by some of those real challenges around the drought, but also by the integration of the Koroit facility, which, as I said, we bought in August. Ladies and gentlemen, in the presentation, there is lots for you to mull over around the half-year performance. I don't intend to go through that half-year performance because it's obviously been presented and is out there to be documented, but I thought that it was more important that I give you a context and an overview of the business. Thank you very much.